You've probably heard the term not due to an abnormal heart valve in primetime advertising for medications to prevent atrial fibrillation-related strokes. But what does all of this lingo mean? How atrial fibrillation causes stroke? Let's see in this video. Welcome to the Scope Care, a safe and soothing place for patients and caregivers of all ages. In this video, we'll talk about how you and your loved ones can protect yourself from atrial fibrillation, what its symptoms are, and how it causes a stroke. So watch this video till the end, and if you'd like to be a part of Scope Care, subscribe to the channel and give this video a thumbs up. Let's get started on our topic. Atrial fibrillation, or AFib, is a cardiac rhythm disorder characterized by a fast and irregular heartbeat arrhythmia that is not caused by an abnormal heart valve. Instead, atrial fibrillation happens due to other causes such as high blood pressure or high thyroid levels, leading to stroke. It is called an arrhythmia when the heart beats too fast, too slowly, or irregularly. Atrial fibrillation affects more than 5 million people in the United States. The atria of the heart's upper chambers begin to quiver ineffectively during AFib. Blood tends to pool and possibly create clots in a little pouch extending from the top of the left atrium when this happens. The left atrial appendage, LAA, is an ear-shaped sac. The left atrial appendage is where 90% of blood clots in the heart form. These clots can escape the clutches from the heart and travel to the brain, where they block blood flow and cause an ischemic stroke. The majority of persons with AFib take anti-clotting drugs to help prevent strokes. Those drugs, however, might cause major bleeding problems in certain people. These medications, also known as blood thinners, are highly harmful to older people who are prone to head injuries from falls, as they increase the risk of bleeding in and around the brain. Procedures to seal off the left atrial appendage may be appropriate for either of these groups of people. Additionally, anyone with AFib who has had a stroke despite taking an anti-clotting medicine may benefit. The standard method entails implanting a device that prevents the left atrial appendage from opening, a device that traps clots. The Food and Drug Administration, or FDA, approved one device, the Watchman, in 2015. It's implanted through a catheter that a cardiologist coils up a leg vein to the heart, just like many other heart devices. The tiny basket-like device is then positioned over the left atrial appendage's opening. Anti-clotting medications must be used for roughly 6 weeks until a layer of cells forms over the device. After that, patients will be able to cease taking the medications. The Watchman worked quite as well as warfarin and Comedan at preventing strokes in people with AFib. Warfarin was still commonly used to prevent clotting at the time, but it has now been entirely supplanted by newer anti-clotting medications known as DOACs. DOACs also compared to closure devices in more recent trials such as the Watchman and a similar device called the Amulet, which was FDA approved in August of 2021. Again, regardless of strategy, the rates of strokes, bleeding, and cardiovascular death were equal. The Watchman is less expensive for patients than the average cost of anti-clotting medications, as well as the drug's bleeding-related consequences over 5 years. Furthermore, the latest versions of the device are more flexible and come in a larger range of sizes, making placement easier. A patient who needs a left atrial appendage closure device is usually given general anesthesia and stay in the hospital overnight. However, they rarely require pain medication and can continue most normal activities immediately, except jogging and heavy lifting in the first few weeks. So, what are the risk factors for getting AFib? Hold on, friends. Are you having a great time with this video? Please let us know in the comments section below. Also, remember to like and subscribe to the Scope Care channel to see more informative content in the future. Now let's discuss the risk factors for getting AFib. The two upper atrial chambers of the heart pulse irregularly and out of rhythm with the two lower ventricle chambers of the heart during atrial fibrillation. AFib can develop in those who have no apparent risk factors. For example, advanced age, heart disease, high thyroid hormone levels, heart attack or congestive heart failure, enlarged left heart chambers, high blood pressure, stress, obesity, diabetes, smoking, chronic kidney disease, lung infections such as pneumonia, chronic lung diseases, and obstructive sleep apnea, and sleep apnea are all known risk factors for non-valvular AFib. So, guys, you should take care of your health and you should be aware of the symptoms of AFib. Symptoms of atrial fibrillation. There are two kinds of heart rhythm irregularities in AFib. First is paroxysmal AFib, which comes and goes, sometimes about exercise or stress, and can stop on its own. Usually it lasts minutes to hours. And another one is persistent AFib, which continues and does not stop. Episodes last longer than 1 week. Long-standing persistent or permanent AFib episodes can last longer than 1 year. Some people with AFib have no symptoms and are only diagnosed after physical testing by a doctor or after a stroke or mini stroke. Patients with AFib symptoms may complain that their heart flutters, quivers, palpates, pounds, or beats against the chest wall, that they feel dizzy, lightheaded, or faint, that they feel weak and nauseous, have shortness of breath, have chest pain or tightness, or that they are exhausted. Now we come to the most important question that everyone should know. Why does AFib increase stroke risk? The occurrence of a stroke is a severe and life-threatening symptom of atrial fibrillation. Blood might not pump out of the heart properly due to irregular heartbeats, and a clot may form in one of the chambers. A piece of the clot, known as an embolus, may break off and move to blood vessels in the brain, kidneys, eyes, or arms and legs. The clot can block blood and oxygen flow to the brain and other organs. Ischemic strokes account for almost 9 out of 10 strokes caused by AFib. A blood thinner can help avoid 6 out of 10 strokes caused by AFib. Use the acronym FAST or FAST to recognize a stroke in others. Face dropping, arms drifting down, slurred speech, time to call 911. If you feel you have a heart rhythm abnormality, the first step is to visit your doctor. Don't ignore any symptoms you're experiencing. Your doctor will ask about your family history of heart disease as well as your specific AFib risk factors. Your heart rate, rhythm, and pulse will all be monitored. An electrocardiogram, or EKG, a test that monitors the heart electrical activity, is usually used to confirm the diagnosis of atrial fibrillation. However, because atrial fibrillation is not always consistent, a standard EKG may look normal, making irregularities harder to identify during an office visit. In these cases, a Holter monitor, a portable EKG, can be worn at home for 24 hours. Monitors that can be used for more than 24 hours are also available. Now, let's discuss the basic treatment of atrial fibrillation. The main goals when treating AFib are treatment number 1, through medication. Reduce the risk of a stroke caused by blood clots, also known as anticoagulation. Atrial fibrillation can double the risk of heart attack and quadruple the risk of stroke if left untreated. Yet many patients are unaware that AFib is a dangerous disorder. They could not even show any signs or symptoms. Patients may undergo treatments, require surgery, or take medications such as anticoagulants. Blood thinners do not actually thin the blood, but they do help prevent blood clots. Antiarrhythmics, such as amiodarone or sotalol, help the heart establish and maintain a regular rhythm. Beta blockers. These medications help to lower your heart rate. Calcium channel blockers help to lower your blood pressure and heart rate. Digoxin is a medicine that is used to control heart rate. It is less widely used, but may be appropriate in some patients. Certain medicines are sometimes compounded. Many patients, for example, take anticoagulants to help avoid blood clots and strokes. In addition, your doctor will use a CHA2DS2 VASC score to assess your stroke risk. Treatment number 2, surgical options. Some people with AFib undergo open-heart surgery to treat a semantic quibble, such as narrowed coronary arteries or a leaking heart valve. They can minimize their risk of stroke by roughly 30% by removing or closing the left atrial appendage during surgery. People should continue to take anti-clotting medicines after surgery. The stroke prevention benefit is meant to add to the protective effect of the medication, not to replace it. AFib causes about 1 in every 7 strokes, and these strokes are usually more severe than strokes caused by other reasons. People with AFib who are doing well on warfarin or a DOAC anti-clotting drug should be confident that when taken regularly, these drugs reduce stroke risk by about 2/3. Those who have already had a stroke while on anticoagulants, have bleeding issues, or are prone to falls should talk to their cardiologist about left atrial appendage closure possibilities. So guys, your health is an essential part of life. Every part of your life relies on you having good mental and physical health. You cannot climb higher in all the areas of your life if you don't have enough physical energy to hit each of them. Likewise, when you have no energy, it isn't easy to express love and intimacy. Without good health, you have nothing. With this, it is time to wrap up today's video. I hope that you found the content informative. Do you want to hear something new from us? Please let us know in the comments section. Stay connected to Scope Care for more interesting content and updates on a healthy lifestyle by liking and subscribing to the channel. Thank you for watching this video. See you in the next video. Keep shining. Bye.